Hello!
Hi.
Well, fantastic musical introduction from Zoë Buckman, our artist of the evening, but also our DJ. Good evening, everybody, if you're in London. Good afternoon, if you're in New York. Zoë's in New York. I'm in London. We are thrilled that you're with us this evening. This is the online private view of Zoë Buckman's exhibition, NOMI, and I am honoured to have curated this exhibition with Pippy Houldsworth Gallery. Of course, we all really want to be together physically, to be with the art, to be drinking together, getting sweaty together, standing around chatting together, and we can't do that. And so we wanted to do something to bring everyone together, to give you some art and to give you some good conversation and to bring us together digitally. So we've created a beautiful online viewing room. We've done our absolute best to allow the work to sing. It's incredible work, Zoë. It's immaculately presented. It's full of heart and soul, and it has to be seen now because this is an exhibition about finding the light through the darkness. And so it's an exhibition that we really felt that we had to do it now, even if we were doing it online. So I'm thrilled to be here to be the host this evening. Zoë, this has been about 2 years in the making, right? This show?
I've been working on it for about 2 years, and then sort of more intensely from the onset of the pandemic. I like many, was given an opportunity to stay the fuck home and go inward or create and go outward. So I sort of revved up in 2020, and I just actually just want to say thank you to everyone who's here on Zoom today. I'm really pleased that you're here, that you're showing up. And yeah, it's a little heartbreaking that we can't do this in the gallery in that beautiful space and have the experience of walking amongst the work. I always have intended for viewers, audiences to come close and have an intimate experience with the work. And so I hope that people spend time with it in whatever context that they can. Thanks, everyone. I've got so many of my gal dem and my family on Zoom today, and I'm really moved, and they're in the work.
There's definitely some familiar faces to people who know you. So there's a link in the chat where you can see the online viewing room. And in a moment, I'm going to introduce, well, actually play a recording, a conversation between Zoë and her great friend, the artist Toyin Ojih Odutola. Now, Zoë, tell us, how do you know Toyin, and sort of why did you want to have a conversation with her particularly about this body of work?
So I've known Toyin for many years, and we met through the art world, really. We're both part of the same community here in New York, and obviously I am such a huge fan of her work. I think she's one of the most, or if not the most, hardworking geniuses I've ever met. She's wonderful. Her work is beautiful. I know pretty much everyone is familiar with it at this point.
In London, it was like one of the shows of 2020 was A Countervailing Theory at Barbican, and I mean, he killed it at the Whitney Museum a couple of years ago as well. I saw that show too. So we're like, yeah, everyone's a big fan.
Huge fans. And then, Toyin and I, we really connected over like both being artists that like make hard work and intricate work, but also like really have a good time. And so you'd often find Toyin and I like at the back of some gallery opening, just laughing and snorting when we laugh and guffawing and making a big old noise. So it's really meaningful that she wanted to have this conversation with me, and also that she went so deep on the work, on viewing it and understanding it, and her questions just, they blew my mind.
I mean, I think it's always a kind of special thing for an artist to talk about their work, particularly after you've been slaving over it for a couple of years. This work is cathartic for you. It's about transformation. It's about learning more about yourself, going deeper. And so when you share it, you're going to feel vulnerable, right? But what's it like having a conversation with an artist about it? Because it's all very well and good talking to other people, but there's no hiding from an artist. They're kind of visually and metaphorically and creatively interrogative in a way that other people might not be. So what's it like when you have to kind of confront one of your peers about your work?
It's fucking terrifying. It's terrifying because, like you said, that they're bullshit receptor is acute. So I was nervous and then also so touched and moved by her.
Well, we're really, really grateful for everyone to be with us this evening. We know that a lot of you are on Zoom all day long, you're at your computers, you know, there's a lot of digital overload. So it means a lot that you're with us this evening. We tried to take that into account. So we've got a different kind of presentation this evening. You're not just going to see two faces talking backwards and forwards. This is about the art after all. So we pre-recorded the conversation between Toyin and Zoë. You're going to hear their voices and it's overlaid over the exhibition. So you see lots of details of the show. Hopefully it's more relaxing, not having to kind of concentrate and always picking up on body language and what's that above her shoulder. And actually you can just listen to these voices, hear these great minds thinking and talking together and actually enjoy this artwork. We're going to be back at the end to take your questions. I'm pretty sure I'll be jumping in there first because I'm busy and I want to talk to Zoë too. And before I do, I just want to congratulate you, Zoë. It's been such a journey putting this show together with you. And we've been on this like whole, how are we going to do it? And you know what's going to happen? But above all, we've just had so many great conversations about these works and the transformative power of art. And it's just the kind of message we all need right now. So thank you so much.
Thank you. Well, wait, hang on then. Before you screen the video, I just want to say thank you, Kate, for your time and your diligence and your keen, incredible eye and voice with this. And thank you to Pippy and the whole Pippy Houldsworth Gallery team who've been working their asses off, off hopefully a really successful online iteration of what is gonna be the real life iteration next year.
Yes.
When we're all
We are all going to be together in the same room, sweaty and drinking. So guys, pour yourself a drink, get a cup of tea, whatever's your poison, and enjoy this.
Cheers.
Zoë.
Yes, my darling.
I would like to discuss, or at least start discussing, what you use as your alter ego, NOMI, which is lace pattern motif. Why that patternistic, why did you consider that patternistic form as your alter ego? What was it about that motif that attracted you?
Right. Well, I guess I've been, there's the alter ego that I guess conjured or gave a name to some years ago when I was doing Jungian psychology. And that was a time when I was feeling very spiritually and creatively trapped and held back by patriarchal forces in my life. So I was working with someone who was trying to encourage me to access an energy within myself that was unchanged by external forces. And we were looking at the shadow, which is a Jungian concept. And he was like, you know, this force, your shadow, like she's risen up and fought for you in the past and she's gotten you out of sticky situations and she creates your work for you. She gave birth for you, et cetera. And I was like, okay, I started to picture this wild woman, bigger than me, stronger than me, more powerful than me. And I gave her the name NOMI, as you know. And then I kind of feel like after, this was some years ago, I kind of feel like I forgot about her a little bit. And though she's been present in everything that I've done since, and she's definitely been with me on life's journey since then, God knows she's had to rise up and fight for me also. I haven't like cognizantly been making an effort to connect with her. So when the pandemic hit, and of course we were all limited and held back, I was very viscerally reminded of like, hang on a minute, there's an energy within me that is free all the time. And it felt very apt to start creating work from a more intuitive place. And as I know you know, I work so often with domestic textiles. And so specifically the doilies, as you asked, those lace round forms, to me, they feel like brains. And when we look at them, we think about maybe our mothers, maybe our grandmothers, they feel very explicitly feminine and of the home. and fragile, but to me they also conjure this idea of the right and left brain, and using ink you can kind of make them bleed and leak and come together, or using very tight mohair thread I can kind of explore this idea of trauma being stuck in between the left and right sides of the brain. And so that is a very long-winded way of saying that.
Oh no, that's actually fascinating. It's even more fascinating because I kind of want to follow up, because one of the things that I was really fascinated by is how you use the NOMI, not only conceptually in your work, but as a material guide, because obviously it's steeped in a process of making. But then I was caught up in the patternations of it, because it's like, it's a very singular, very recognizable motif. And I thought of it as almost like a meditative state, sort of like the vibrations. And it's really interesting that you said, or you linked it to the brain, because I thought it was something that felt very instinctive to you and a meditative state, because so much of what I think you play with is the powerful forces that you described of patriarchy, violence, trauma. But at the same time, there's so many things, especially in ancient cultures or indigenous cultures, that employ that kind of, not the NOMI, but that kind of patternation in order to deal with life, in order to sort of take all of these uncontrollable forces and kind of, I don't say dilute it, what's the word I'm looking for? Like, you want to put it into a place that is controlled.
Yes,
is understood. And it's translated in a way that, you know, your brain and your emotional self and your well-being in a way can kind of deal with that. And have it be in that place. And so I wondered if you are using it not just for that purpose, but also for the audience.
Yes.
To sort of take a lot of that heavy stuff and like put it into a form that is accessible to them.
Yeah. And is and does speak, is archetypal. Like, we've got mandalas, we've got, you know, so much of these curving snake motifs, speak to like a kundalini, but also speak to, you know, deities for fertility and goddesses and whatnot. And then also it's interesting what you've touched upon, because it makes me think about, I remember my mother telling me of this like old, I think, religious adage that, which is fucked up, by the way, it's that woman is a piece of silk, a man is a piece of gold. And if you drop gold in the dirt, no problem, just dust it off. But if you drop a piece of silk in the dirt, it's ruined forever. And that's so loaded, obviously, speaking about chastity and perfection and, you know, all of these things that still bind us as women. But that's something that really encouraged me to look more at materials, silks, linens, lace, for that very idea, this notion that if it's stained, it's ruined and you can't get it out. But you and I know the stains are what make these things remarkable and beautiful.
Absolutely. That's
where the story is, you know? Yeah.
There is a beautiful, I mean, I'm just looking at your amazing work and I'm just really struck by how the figure has been introduced. You have been playing with the figure or the figuration in your work very tentatively, if I'm correct, in the past.
Yeah.
It seems like you're leaning into it more and more, but you're doing it in such a way that it's almost like the figure is unreliable in these. Yes. It's almost like they're just barely there and then they can go away at any moment. It's like you said, the stain, but the stain itself is unreliable.
It's completely uncontrollable. And even the process, so you're absolutely right. This is the first time that I've actually been literally using forms, women, us dancing, raving, pictures, that people had taken of me praying in India, and then these predatory animals. And the process of ink staining on the fabric. You know, I wet the fabric, I do the embroidery, I wet the fabric, and then I drop ink onto it. And then I have no idea what's going to happen, because it just very quickly bleeds out and has its own life. And like us can't be controlled, like us can't be, you know, diminished or made to go over here. Like it will, she will rape. Do you know what I mean? And so, yeah, I've really enjoyed. It's good for me, who someone who is a control freak and can be a perfectionist. It's good for me to have a practice where I'm like, okay, here we go, kiss it up to God. Like, we'll see when it dries what happened with this piece, you know?
You're letting that process dictate how the picture is going to come out in the end.
Exactly.
But I also, the reason why I asked, what I meant by unreliable is that somehow you obscure the figure, you obscure the snake, you know, you obscure any sort of like completed picture or completed figuration. Mm-hmm. Everything has to be, has this obfuscation that we cannot fully see the form.
Mm-hmm.
And I wondered what that was about.
I think that for me is very much about transformation and a shedding of the skin, and the fact that I feel that we're all in progress beings, like we're not complete, we're figuring this out, and that's what makes us beautiful. So the threads are loose and they're coming down, and some things, some parts of the bodies or the animals are obscured by the ink itself, and they look like they're emerging from or actually swallowed up by. I've also been embroidering with white thread as well, and you can barely see that.
There's such a expectation, I think, also coming out of 2020, you know, which is when you made this work, that people need something certain. There was a craving for certainty, there was a craving for a common ground. And one thing that I've noticed with your work is that it's almost like easing people out of that idea. It's like there's no common ground at all.
Yeah.
There's the psychology aspect of our lives, which is very mercurial, which is very much unreliable. And it's constantly changing. It's like history.
Right.
It's constantly undoing itself and reaffirming itself. And then you have the material. So there's a story of that, which, you know, bleeds into all kinds of things, societal expectations, you know, the implications of being a woman in our time. But then there's the material story that I'm really, really fascinated by, because it's very delicate and subtle. You know, your work isn't hard hitting, with the exception, of course, of the gloves, which I want to get into a little bit later. But I'm looking at a lot of the, for instance, I'm looking at slow dancing, white embossed ovals through my veins, which is like a serpentine, you know, a snake that's coming through. And then it looks like, I'm guessing there's another lace over it.
Yeah.
Something imprinted over it that obscures the form completely from our view. So we can only see parts of the snake. And it's not just that. There's other pictures where that same kind of like placement of something over it. It alters our idea or our expectations about, oh, why can't we see this completely? Is it because our perspective is blocked? We can't access that information because that's just the way that life is. That's how our psychology is. That's how we process information, how we understand ourselves, how we understand the world. How do we understand the motives of others?
Yeah,
absolutely. And I wonder, am I reading into it?
No, you're dead on, babe. You're dead on.
I'm glad, because I don't want to put in the projection.
No, you're dead on. That particular piece of text was speaking to a time when my I was not fully conscious because of Xanax and alcohol, and I experienced violence and from the hands of someone I would never have expected that from. And so speaking to this idea of like not being fully conscious and aware of what's in front of us, and having one's consent taken and reformed, and then by using the snake and making the snake almost like pregnant. Or it also reminded me of you know, those images of snakes that like when they eat their prey and then they They look like a normal snake, but then with this giant thing in their tummy.
Oh, bro.
You know? I'm like, wait, is there,
they're digesting.
Is this like just a very full up snake? But no, you're right. It's also looking at layers of obscurity, and there are two different pieces of textiles there, and then obviously the collage bit and the text as well. And I guess like the space in between, that slippage in between of and allowing there to also be space visually for the viewer to draw their own conclusions.
Absolutely. Yeah. Absolutely. I mean, I love that you open up not only in the terms of how the work is constructed, but how it, the meanings that are attached to the work. It's really opened up to the viewer to kind of impart their own experience and their own interpretations, which I think is very powerful and very, like, it seems to me, because I gotta ask it.
Okay.
Poetry is very important to you.
Yes.
In the titles of the work, in the actual work itself, there's words that are woven into the image.
Mm-hmm.
Talk to me maybe about your relationship to poetry. It says here that you have been doing an ongoing poem titled, and let me make sure I got this correct, Show Me Your Bruises Then,
yeah,
which is like an ongoing sort of project that you have incorporated through multiple exhibitions and multiple series.
Yes.
What is the role of poetry for you, not only in the making of the work, but how you kind of like process your ideas?
Yeah, great question. Thank you, babe. So I grew up, you know, my mum was this acting teacher and this Shakespeare expert. So I grew up with the art of language and literature very much within the home. But as you know, I also grew up in East London, where the predominant culture was hip hop, whether it's American hip hop or like British hip hop, and beat poetry was a big thing. And so it was just very linguistically rich, my upbringing. I've always loved and really appreciated words, cuss words, swear words, language. I'm all for it. And then in 2018, I was asked to write for a newspaper. They asked me for a 300 word essay on my experience of 2018. And they said to me, you can make it as abstract as you want. Now, if you tell an artist that, they will run with that idea, right?
Yeah. So don't tell us abstract.
No, like, we'll do that. So I got all excited and I put together this like little mini essay where I was weaving together snippets of conversations and things that people had said to me, like other women sharing and things that I had said or had been told by men. And all the text was pertaining to bleeding, bruising, or having your power taken away from you. And I submitted it to the newspaper and they were like, absolutely not. This is way too abstract. Can you please write us something much more basic? So right. I went, okay, no surprises there. But so I wrote them something else. But then I had like the beginning of something that I thought was pretty rich there and quite fertile ground for expression. So I started to embroider that text. And again, this was some years ago. And since then, really, I've just been expanding the poem. It's now called Show Me Your Bruises Then. And it's got a lot going on in there.
Very powerful words. And I that's what I meant by like process of thinking. It's almost as if it's like sometimes the way that the words are incorporated into the I keep calling drawings.
That's all good.
You know, in my mind. But I sense that like there, it's like you're exposing a stream of consciousness.
Yes.
You know, mantra work. And this idea of like, there's just like these moments that you might like catch on a subway, you know, like eavesdropping and it goes away.
Yes.
You know, or like you're walking down a street and you might hear like a conversation pass you and you turn and it's gone.
Right, and, absolutely.
But you like trap them in these works, and we have the luxury as a viewer to be privy to these moments, these thoughts, these ideas, this lexicon, because they feel very much like idiosyncratic too.
You know, because they're
you know what I mean? They're like parts of all these different dialogues, whether they be internal in ourselves or just between other people. And suddenly it's like we have access to that. But yet, again, juxtaposition that with the forms of people we don't see fully.
Right.
So it's like this like cross section of two things where the words and the images together are not at opposition, but it's almost as if like there's something that is accessible and there's just certain things that you don't know and you have to put it on faith. You just got to like make up what your meaning is from your vantage point.
Absolutely.
It doesn't mean your vantage point is invalid. Doesn't mean that your vantage point is wrong. But it means that this is where you're at. This is the space you're in. Right. How do you create meaning from that space?
Right, absolutely. It's something that I know that you're, that you examine in your work, like most recently with your show, Tell Me a Story. I don't care.
If it's true.
I fucking love that series, Toyin. I'm all about that.
Thank you so much.
Where there's this space, where there's this visual space, but there's this like, symbolic space where it's really it's up to us. And I feel that there are pieces where I'm also trying to push that, like there's a work in this series that says you're walking fine to me, looks like you're walking fine to me, I think. You know, I've had people be like, oh, that's like a cat call, or like that's when I remember Cleo's babysitter being like, that's when the guy wants to keep going and you don't want to keep going. And they're like, please, you look like you're walking fine to me. Or is it something much more sinister? You know, I'm interested in things that, like things that you can overhear, or something that someone can say in a throwaway manner that is actually incredibly loaded, incredibly complex and complicated. And then there are other works where I feel I'm putting, I guess, more of a pointed poetic voice into the piece. There's one called Reality's Form, and it's like, it's these honeycomb shape doilies presented. And it says, I can't remember.
Did that split second reminding her of reality's form?
Yeah, and that to me, like I've been thinking a lot about the familial and almost nostalgic feeling of when you know that you're not safe, and I've been reflecting back recently on how that is something that almost like a sixth sense or a second skin or what have you. It's like, I know this feeling so well. Like I've seen it since I'm 3 years old. It's in the living room. It's in the first job I ever got as a junior, you know, in a hair salon. It's in the workplace, it's outside the club. Or even as a grown ass woman, it's in my own home when my baby's sleeping next door, you get me? But it's that awareness when you're like, oh, you're about to switch. And when you switch, I am yet again let down by the fact that I am in the smaller body. Why am I always in the fucking smaller body for this shit? You know, and I know, like, you know, I get big in moments of conflict. I'll always try and you know, get loud, get leery, or swear or whatever, or try and like diffuse the situation by maybe making them back down. And then there has unfortunately been moments throughout my life where I've gone, I'm not gonna win this. Why? Because I'm in the fucking, that's the reality of my form. Here I am again, I can't get out of this. And so, you know, there are pieces in this series where I'm really looking at and talking in more specific ways about what it is to be in a woman's body in relationship to other men.
And the power dynamics in that. I think one of the things that I'm really glad that you mentioned that, because I sense from this series specifically, a sort of like, and I'm trying to be very careful with this, because I don't sense in any way that your work is about powerlessness. I do not. I do not sense that it is an angry, there is anger in the work, but it's not an angry series as a whole. What I sense is this is the experience of, and I love this, the reality of my form. I love that phrase. But this idea that this person, me, you, anyone who's been marginalized, anyone who's ever been afraid, mm-hmm. and feels like they don't have ownership of their body, that that is in the hands of another person. Mm-hmm. That experience, it's not even that it's the trauma of that, but everyone knows the feeling of that. Mm-hmm. And it happens in you know, the earliest memory, right, is the fear, fight or flight, right?
Right.
That is when you're like, I have to protect my body because I know that now I don't control whether or not it will be safe. Mm-hmm. Why I keep coming back to the piece Gully.
Oh, Gully, yeah.
And I keep thinking about that feeling that we all kind of have or we become cognizant of when we're very young, maybe like 5, mm-hmm. 6 years old, 10 years old, you know, max. And suddenly we're like, I don't have ownership of this body. Mm-hmm. Someone else has ownership of it, control of it, power over it, mm-hmm. all of those things.
Yes.
And because of that, the meaning of my body in whatever space it is like up to, it's subject to anything. Mm-hmm. It can be absolved and subsumed into anything.
Yes.
It can be tainted. You know, there's so many levels to this.
Yeah. Yeah.
But the thing that I really wanted to focus on is meaning, because mm-hmm. meaning is power. Mm-hmm. And if you register the meaning of your body in a space being threatened, mm-hmm. that changes how you interact within that space and with others.
Yeah, absolutely.
And so I'm looking at Gully, and I mean, immediately that was the first thing I don't know, something about this piece stopped me in my tracks.
Oh, wow.
It was about this thing about the way that the mohairs, and I'm guessing it's also a staining effect
yeah. in
the materiality of it. First of all, girl, go off. But it's just like the way that it just subtly bleeds into that, the motif of the collage motif. Mm. And it's like in process, mm-hmm. midway. Yeah. And you snatched it, you captured that.
Yeah.
And I think that was something in my mind, again, this is just my interpretation. But in that moment, I thought that's in our brains when we realize things can go in any way
yeah.
at any moment. I can be subsumed at any moment.
Yeah.
And most people, let's be clear, who are in power don't know that feeling very well.
No. Exactly.
It's usually people who aren't in, you know, who have been taken, who have, you know, who have had violences put upon them, that mm-hmm. have been refugees of some kind. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. They know that feeling instinctively. They yeah. know exactly what that is.
Exactly.
But suddenly 2020 happened. Mm-hmm. And then everybody had that feeling. It was like you couldn't get away with it, you know? Now it's like, wait, what is the ground I stand on? Mm-hmm. What is the most reliable foundation I have? And 2020 was like, honey, none. We're on a rock floating in space. What do you think is reliable?
Right.
Nothing.
Right. Yeah.
And then what I love is that you call attention to that. Again, I could be projecting. Please correct me.
No, you're right on so many levels, babe. I mean, first of all, I feel that this is the most joyful work I've ever made, honestly. Mm. And though there is...
I feel like maybe I'm taking
No, you're absolutely right. You're absolutely right. Though there is, of course, with the text and with a lot of it, there is, I'm speaking about trauma, I'm speaking about domination, I'm speaking about violence in all its forms. I am also looking at joy and exaltation, love, freedom, our capacity to go through the things that we go through and still throw down in a nightclub and use our bodies in that way, you know, to celebrate our forms and the reality of our forms, you know. And so often with the images, whether it's someone twerking or praying, there's this kind of, I'm looking at the way often our bodies are in the same positions, whether you're encountering violence or whether you're throwing your hands up in the air celebrating. You know, is someone screaming or are they in ecstasy? Is that an orgasm? Or is that a situation where there's violence and domination? And so you're pretty dead on with all of that, honestly.
And that piece is
very much looking at these bodies emerging out of this motif where there's this kind of like this darkness and this
yeah, and it's out. Dripping down. But I don't see it as nefarious at all. I think it was actually quite like almost comforting for me at least. I felt that it was almost like this is what it is.
Yeah,
it doesn't need to explain itself. Mm-hmm. It's just that is the truth. That is truth. And then this beautiful like sort of border, this red border around the edge, and I mean gorgeously done. And then of course that staining effect at the bottom that gradually creeps up. Mm-hmm. So there's always that thin line between violence and joy, you know. It's like, you know, it could go either way. At literally the turn of a dime, which again is back to that idea of like nothing is certain, you know. Mm-hmm. you don't know, even in situations that could be a safe space can turn into something very different very quickly.
Yeah, 100%.
I guess going off of that, the violence, the, you know, that sort of like tilting of the coin, violence and joy, I want to go into the boxing gloves. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Which is what you're most known for. I find that was what really set off your career, because mm-hmm. you were able to take or sort of mitigate really two very powerful sensations, you know, masculine and feminine, the, you know, what is joy and violence, the things that are very intimate, and then the things that are also very public. Mm-hmm. And it seemed like those gloves often straddle both worlds very seamlessly, I think. Mm-hmm. And I wondered in this series, you've taken them into a further space, because mm-hmm. the materiality of how they're made in the past, when I first saw them and I was just blown away, was the wedding dresses. They were made up of wedding dresses that you had assembled. The material choices for these gloves, how did they shift for you in this series?
Yeah, so I've been, thank you, babe, by the way. I've been looking a lot more at the home and domesticity. And so all of the fabrics in this series on the gloves and on the flatworks too are some kind of domestic textile, whether that's a hanky or a tablecloth, a table runner. The one with the red border that you speak of, that's actually, those belong to my mum. So it's, super meaningful for me to use those. And I also used, because she gave me a little set. I don't know who they belonged to. I'm guessing my grandmother. But I used that same fabric on these two gloves, that where one is balancing on the other. And those to me, with these glove clusters and sculptures, like some of them you've got gloves sort of facing the same way and almost like supporting each other, mm-hmm. and or like a pair that's very much that, right, yeah. Exactly, and they can feel like two pieces that, you know, perhaps even in love, or there's an intimacy between one and the other. And then you've got, right, exactly, absolutely. Mm-hmm. And then you've got some where there's one, is that one pulling the other down?
Or yes, is that, I was like, yeah.
Right, is that something actually lifting someone up and out? Mm-hmm. For me, I started to make those works, or I guess flip them for the first time, the gloves, when my mum was terminally ill. And I wasn't really thinking about it too deeply at the time. I was obviously had quite a lot on my mind, but I look back at that now and I really think about how there was someone slipping away from me, and I was desperate to hold on to that person. And there's that kind of, I don't know, that like that anxiety of something being balanced on the other and not knowing if it's about to fall or when it's going to fall. So that work is very much about the home, a lot about my mum, but also shared experiences that I've had with my mother, to do with, again, the home and power.
Was the material, the fabric itself, dictating the narratives and how you position these gloves and how you were trying to create different like situations with them, mm-hmm. or was it already in your mind and you were just using the fabric to sort of extend that, or to kind of like find a way for the fabric to help you manifest create this narrative?
Right. So often when something arrives in the studio, so I collect these vintage fabrics exactly as you said, because they come to me already with a history and already with their own stories. Mm-hmm. And then from that, I may have an idea of something that I want to make, but it's not really until it's there in the studio that I can see, you know, well, does it have stains? What's going on over here? What happens if I rip it? What happens if I cut it? The two pieces that you reference, I'm absolutely looking at this idea of the earth, you know, whether it's like almost like snake-like bits of fabric coming down, or those flowers on that piece and Ganga water glistens. That's very much, I guess, inspired by or informed by the experience of taking my mother's ashes to India, where I offered them back to the Himalayan Ganges, which is said, which by the way is freezing cold water. I got in after I did it. But it's said that water is said to be pure spiritual feminine energy. And that when you put ashes into the water, it's, I guess, putting the mother back into the mother. They call it Mother Ganga, the river. And those fabrics, those were my mum's. And so those flowers and trailing away and trickling down really reminded me of the way her ashes, which were so much, I'd never done this before, they were so much lighter in color than I expected them to be. And they were, when I poured them in with my daughter Cleo by my side, they made these really beautiful swirling patterns, and they quite swiftly like danced away downstream. Mm-hmm. And it was stunning. I think it was definitely one of the most memorable moments in my life, of my life. And then I got in, and girl, I dunked. Like traditionally when you take a ceremonial dunk in the water, you go back three times. Mm. And on the third like immersion into the water, I opened my eyes and thought about the fact that within this water actually is the remnants of my mom's body. Like it's still, right. It's still got to be like some kind of
surrounding you,
article, yeah, somewhere. And I opened my eyes and I saw this flash of light, and it was so cold, I'm pretty sure that my heart might have stopped and that I died and was reborn. At least that's,
oh my gosh,
that's how I felt. Wow. I came out of that like hands in the air, like whoa, like I felt like I was on fire when I came out of the water. So it was, wow, it was a very formative moment and journey, and that's what started my year. I went in January 2020. So my year started with like offering back and ceremonial bathes in the water and rebirth and all of this like good shit and transition, and then came back to the lockdown and was like, all right, let's get to work.
What was the effect of the bleeding ink wash?
Yeah
that I see often. What was it about that? Because it appears, mm-hmm, in different works in different ways, and I wondered what that was for you in the making and why you chose it.
Yeah, so you know, you're right, I'd never used ink before, or any paint in any way,
right.
And then, you know, lockdown hits, and of course I'm thinking a lot about my mum, and you know, where she was a writer, she also would, like, I remember there was like a period in like the 90s where she really, it was all about fountain pens, like, mm-hmm, and that would almost like excite her, like getting a new fountain pen, and like she and her things would start to smell of ink. Mm-hmm. And I associate her little room and that smell with her and her creation, and then also like her demons and her trauma. And then of course there's this thing she told me that she was examining in her work about this idea of woman as a piece of silk ruined by dirt. So it felt very apt to start. I literally just Amazon primed some fountain pen ink, opened it up and was like, oh my god, this smell, yes, let's go. So yeah, it felt very apt to start staining the fabrics with the ink.
And because the reason I ask is because that also adds to that idea of this image is not fully formed. Mm-hmm. This image is constantly being undone and redone, because, mm-hmm, its meaning is being undone and redone.
Absolutely.
And, you know, that was what 2020 was.
Yeah.
Meeting became very suspect. What were words in 2020? What were images in 2020? Nothing seemed to, there was no consensus.
Yeah, there was nothing, absolutely. There was you nothing know? To take shelter of but your own self and your own relationship with yourself or your relationship to the divine or you know, the things that, nothing was certain. I didn't even know if there was going to be an art world. There was a minute where I was like, I mean, well, my career is fucked.
Hello.
You know what I mean? So hello? I was like, well, and then I stopped and I thought, but I've never made my artwork for the art world anyway. Mm-hmm. Like I've never made work for a gallery or to sell it or for people to write about it. That's never been my motivation. So why am I going to stop now? And in fact, I found it really like fertile time creatively, and a time where we were all given a moment to connect very deeply with the things that we do find certain and joyful and free within ourselves. And I became so like abundantly impressed by and inspired by the women in my life, yourself included, who I just think it's amazing that I have found and continue to seek out relationships with women who all have a firm relationship with their inner wilderness, you know, with their own NOMI in whatever context and whatever form. Mm-hmm. So I feel like this work it's a celebration of me and you and all of us and our capacity to like overcome and resist.
I just looked at the images yesterday and then I read the text this morning, and the one thing that I really wanted to talk to you about is this idea of how your works feel ancient because of the vintage, again, the materials that you use, but also very new at the same time, simultaneously ancient, old, weathered, you know, full of history, but also at the same time, because of the way you collage things, the juxtapositions of meaning and literally how these forms are comprised, feel very fresh and very new and very prescient. Your work, and please correct me if this is wrong, but it helps us ease into death.
I feel like that's the greatest compliment.
It's not scary to me.
Thank you, mate.
You know what I mean? Like that's something that's literally been the human story since time immemorial.
Yeah.
So it's not like it's, you know, but it's for some reason we became invincible in the 21st century. Yeah. Like nothing can harm us. We're everything, technology, the world is so fast. Da, da, da. No, we could die at any time.
Yes,
we can be harmed at any time. So what is meaning now with that knowledge?
Yeah,
with that exactly. Truth.
Yeah,
and that meaning is what you choose. Sorry, I didn't mean to interrupt
you. No, not at all, not at all. I'm about that. I think that the first solo show that I ever had, it was actually right after I had given birth, and I was honestly, Toyin, I was consumed with thoughts of death, not suicidal thoughts, but just this notion that hang on a minute, I've made life and I think she's perfect and she's gonna die. Like I held my newborn baby and was like, yeah, she'll die. Like that's actually fact, bruv. And I'm going to, and that Rats. Person is over there, and that person is, and shit, like everything that lives dies. That's life. That's the human condition. Mm-hmm. And therefore I have to find beauty in that. Do you know what I mean? Like it has to be, cause it's fucked up. So it has to also be like fucked up and beautiful, right. Fucked up and fascinating. And so, yeah, it's interesting that I've sort of circled back in the last couple of years and the last two series of works to, as you say, to death, really, to mortality. And so I love you for seeing that, because not a lot of people see that in the work, and I really appreciate that. That's nuanced.
I mean, I think it's a gift that you've given people, because somebody might go through this work on many levels. They're beautiful, you know, just aesthetically. There's a language that aesthetic. The NOMI that we talked about earlier. Mm-hmm. There's also a history to the materials and a meaning to the materials, narrative meaning, materials that you use. That's an access point for people. But I also sense that the heart coming out of when you made it, coming out of what you've experienced, and what we've all kind of collectively experienced, is this idea that, yes, nothing is certain, but that's okay. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Because what you choose to do with the time you are allotted right now is the definitive. That's all the meaning you need. Mm. You don't need to seek it in all these other things. Mm. Right now, this choice you make. And I thought, I love it. And I want to end it on this one.
Yes. Tell
on
me.
On a positive. Maybe I could have been more peaceful. Yes. That piece. Because it's the most, I mean, there's a few pieces that are explicitly text, but mm-hmm. that one is very interesting to me because you bring in the leaf. It's like a sort of foliage mm-hmm. that comes, that grows out.
Yeah.
Peaceful. And then just kind of, again, just gently cascades down. Mm-hmm. That's when I knew, at least for my sense, that you were like holding our hands with this, like, all right, I'm about to let go of your hand. Like, this is life. Let's go. Tell me a little bit about that.
That piece is very much about me taking those words that have been said to me and owning them and like rewriting them and making them beautiful.
I wanted to ask about that piece because I actually feel that is a very beautiful sort of prayer to oneself.
Oh, I love that.
And thank you for that. Thank you for this incredible body of work, for your rigor, for your investigative mind. And listen, in the art world that we exist in, where there are so many presentations, you have sculpture in here, you have painting, embroidery. You've incorporated so many different processes and mediums, and that in itself is an amazing accomplishment. And you know what?
Oh, mate.
And I think that, you know, the fact that you keep pushing it, you keep growing, you're learning with each series. That's exciting. Absolutely. To me, and I see nothing but greatness to come, sis.
Girl, okay. Thank you so much.
You're great. Congrats.
Truly.
Oh, babe, I could have listened to that forever. You two have such a beautiful conversation. There were so many things that resonated for me there. I think Toyin, like me, saw so much power in the work for the moment that we're in now. I think you've always been really generous with the work that you've made. Like, it's always been actually quite prescient. Like, you put this enormous neon sculpture 40 feet high on Sunset Boulevard just before the Oscars, like just after Me Too, you know, post Harvey Weinstein, LA, and you basically presented them an image of women absolutely not tolerating this anymore, about power, about strength, about sort of subjugation and manipulation and reinterpretation. And that was like right at that moment. And I think this body of work has arrived in this particular moment. I think you're kind of a cultural clairvoyant who, you know, gives us what we need when we need it. And I suppose that's because the work comes so much from the heart. But you are someone who's conscious of your audience. I feel like you're a generous artist. You definitely leave space for us. You know, you said there earlier on to Toyin, I wouldn't care if the art world ended because, you know, I don't make it for the art world. I don't know if that's entirely true. I think you're certainly making it for people. I don't know about like fancy art world people that you and I are like not that keen on, but you're making it for people, for real people.
Yes, absolutely. You're absolutely right. I am aware of audiences, and I'm aware of telling stories and creating works that people feel seen in. So you know, I don't make something to put it in a storage cupboard. Like, I want you and I want you all, and I want people there engaging with it. That's my goal. But I never made work with the intention of like a gallery, a physical space, or sales, or you know, write up. So we all thought that it was kind of the end of the art world. And I did panic. I was not feeling good about that for a hot minute. And then I just had to have a chat with myself and remind myself that that isn't the motivation of the work. So you can stop now if you want to rest. you can stop now if you want a break, but don't stop now because you think the art world's gone down the toilet.
Yeah, such a good point. We've had some absolutely brilliant questions. The first question that came in is from Gina Soden. She's an artist, and she said she loves these new works and this gathering. She's enjoying it. She wants to be more personal in her practice. Do you have any advice about navigating this? Like, how do you draw the line about putting yourself into the work? Because there's obviously a concern about making work that could then later upset you. And you've shared a lot this evening. There's some really personal stuff there. You know, there's, you know, things that belong to your mum in these artworks. Her actual possessions have now manifested differently. So have you got any advice to artists who are thinking about that personal life?
I think that's a great question. I think, first of all, there's this thing that I experience after I show work and after I do like a talk. It will probably happen as soon as I close my laptop, which is I feel a bit sick sometimes. And I was listening to a Brené Brown podcast, and she spoke about vulnerability, a vulnerability hangover. But now I know that I'm going to get that. Yeah. Where it's like, I've shared a piece of myself and now I'm like, oh, I feel gross. Like, I don't, because it's really super vulnerable. And then there's this part inside that goes, girl, no one cares about that shit. Like, you shouldn't be talking about yourself. Like, what makes you think that your experience is even interesting? Like, so that voice rises up. And I think that can be add to this kind of like head fuck of when you share something from your heart, right? But I do also think that it is good to be aware of trying to toe that right line between being authentic, vulnerable, if you want to be, and oversharing and being self-indulgent, because we are alive and making work in a time where it is kind of culturally acceptable to be a little narcissistic, right? Thanks to social media. And so I've developed these sort of criteria that I know I've spoken to you before about it, Kate.
I love it. Tell everyone, because it's so handy.
Okay, so I ask myself these questions once I've made something before I share it. And that is, does this work need to be made by me? Like, maybe it's someone else's story, right? Maybe it's someone else's practice. Does this work need to be made by me now? And then if yes to those, then is this work authentic? And is this the best way to tell this story? Is this the best way to make this work? And then lastly, is it well made? Because that's really important to me. And is this an overshare or self-indulgent? And I do think that question's important. And I added that one on in recent years because it's something that I want to be aware of in my practice.
That is really, really shit hot advice to people. So Diana Maskia says, I'm hoping Zoë could please speak a bit about her influences within the female art canon, specifically the artists who are intersectional and see themselves as advocates. Zoë undoubtedly will have an important place in the contemporary canon. And Diana runs Invest in Her Art, which you can find on Instagram, which is awesome. So
yeah, thank you.
That's women artists, which you and I can do all day, babes.
My favorite thing to talk about. I'm really so inspired by, well, probably no surprises that I'm really inspired by Louise Bourgeois, who is no longer around, but her work just is completely timeless and incredible. And she makes work about the home and about trauma and heartbreak and darkness and demons, but there's also so much tactile yumminess in her work. I'm also really inspired by Wangechi Mutu, and she and I traded some work early on in my career, and she gave me this piece of this kind of like pregnant snake bird vomiting goddess, which has been in my home since then, and I think is definitely a huge inspiration to this work. And also Lorna Simpson, and Sophie Cow, and Sarah Maple, who was on here earlier. I fucking love her work. She's sharp.
Shout out to the Mapes. We've also got a question from Francesca Hayes. Have you ever discarded a piece because the finished work doesn't represent your idea or your vision as you expected?
Yes, 100%. And I got some really good advice from a friend of mine who's a curator called Jasmine Wahi. And she said that she always encourages artists to cannibalize their own artwork. I thought that was really interesting because I think what she's talking about there is, you know, maybe something wasn't successful. You didn't deem it successful. It didn't do what you wanted it to. You could burn it, but then maybe do something with the ashes. It's like, you know, instead of discarding it, how can you turn that into another work? And I've done that. Like I've made things that I just think, oh, that's pants, and I put it away. And then maybe a year later, I'll be like, hang on a second, and I can cut something from that, and that can actually become something else.
Yeah, nice. Someone's asked, what is an OVR? That's my fault. The OVR is the
I didn't even know what that was until yesterday.
Yeah, it was the online viewing room. And I think, I mean, the rest of it is just fantastic. Vulnerability hangover is so good as a term, by the way. I think we're all going to borrow that. Okay, and also I'm should be looking in this box. Caitlin D'Amico, I guess. I feel that my work is also multidisciplinary and takes on many forms. How do you keep consistency, or how do you deal with consistency in the work? And they go on to talk about how do you feel like there's a pressure to have a particular style, which I think a lot of people do.
Yeah, I do feel that pressure, but I'm also someone that I'm both limited in my skill set, let's be real, and I'm also someone who's always trying to learn new things. So 2 years ago when I was making work for my last solo show, which was called Heavy Rag at Fort Gansvoort, it was really important to me to include and try working with ceramics for the first time. And that as a discipline, though I'd never used ceramics before, porcelain and making these small cups and intricate, it felt very akin to my embroidery. So I was like, oh, that's a practice that like I can expand and learn how to do that. But there's something about it that feels very familiar to me. But, you know, as you can see, there's not big marble or bronze sculptures and stuff because I don't know how to do that shit. Yeah. So I've always, you know, wanted to make work that kind of draws you in and has you come close and is intimate.
I think a lot of your work is united. In fact, all of your work is united by two things, a kind of consistency of message, but also it's very tactile. Even when you're working with neon, you work in neon in a way which is tactile. Like you're interested in our relationship to these things as objects. You know, I would never really call your work the two-dimensional work. It's the flat work or the work that goes on the wall, because everything has got such a sort of depth to it. Someone is asking here, at the moment, and at a time when artists are sharing significant amounts of work digitally, do you find it a challenge to convey your work when it's so rich and tactile? Which I think we've touched upon. Actually, the second part of this question by someone anonymous is a great question, and I'm going to ask it because I don't think I've ever asked that before. Oh, it's from Katie. What do you think happens when we rest in final peace? This is from Katie.
That's such a good question.
I've never been asked that, and I've never asked anyone it, so I'm asking on behalf of Katie, yeah.
Wow. I'm still working out my theories about it. And I also recognize that
when you talked about your mom, it just gave me such goosebumps. I mean, I'm sure it did to everyone. It's just like,
wow. I think about it all the time, because I'm grieving, and I think I'll probably always be someone who's grieving because that was the depth of that love and that relationship. I don't think it's something that I'll ever get over. So it occupies my thoughts a lot. And in fact, I hope it's okay to say that. First of all, apologies for the swear words if there's any children watching, but I did recently take a little bit of magic mushrooms and I looked up at the stars. I was in a place where you could see really beautiful stars. and I was just struck by this feeling of like, is that where they go? I don't personally believe in a heaven or a hell, but I do think that what is likely is that you kind of become part of everything, and that's quite comforting to me. I'm gonna go with that theory for now because I like the idea of there being some kind of still aroundness, still recycling.
We come from, you know, we're born from stardust and we go back to stardust. That's what I want.
Right.
Well, this has been really, really marvelous. We've got so many people still on with us, even though we've been going over, well over an hour. So that's really amazing to everyone. Please spend more time with the online viewing room. The link is here. It's going to be on PP's website as well for the rest of the month that the show is on. Share it, talk about it. Hopefully that you can find inspiration and healing and transformation within this body of work, like I have being part of it. And thank you so much for Pippy Houldsworth for hosting us this evening. And to you, Zoë Buckman, and to Toyin for giving such great questions. Honestly, what a marvelous thing to listen to. Genuinely a tonic that we needed.
Thank you so much. Thank you, everyone. Truly.
Big love.
Appreciate it. Bye.